Father, we just acknowledge our complete dependence upon you. We submit to the mentorship of God the Holy Spirit to take the things of Christ as he promised in John 16 and reveal them to us. And so we submit to and humbly bow to the third person, the Trinity, to bring us into that which is described as our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Great is the mystery of godliness, which is ultimately Christ in you all of us, your people, Lord, the hope of glory. So may that hope of glory arise in our hearts today as the person who is the object and the substance and the source of that hope, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm just going to read a few scriptures to pick up where we left off. We're looking at the revelation of the mystery of the Christ. And the Christ is specific in that it's head and body that defines the Christ in the revelation of the mystery of the Christ, as was uniquely given to the Apostle Paul. The head is the God-man. He's unique. The body is not the head. The head is definitely a part of the body and one with the body, but the body is never one with the head in terms of deity. God is God, remains infinitely unique and separate from creation. Only God is from everlasting to everlasting, and he remains that way. But as the Christ, God in the man, Christ Jesus, as the Christ, that's one organic whole and entity. To be defined as a part of the Christ, members of the Christ, that's what we're continuing to look at. In the prophecy of Isaiah, chapter 9, verse 6, the prophecy that is quoted often at Christmas, the incarnation, in Isaiah 9, 6, "For a child will be born to us." That's the incarnation. "A son will be given to us." Now, how do we understand that? Well, for the Jewish mindset, there is a gap right there. There is a prophetic parenthesis. A son will be given in fullness as to the prophetic promise of God to Israel when Jesus returns at the second advent. A son will be given. He'll be given as their savior and their deliverer. But there is that which pertains to the mystery. The child will be born to us. There's the incarnation. A son will be given to us. So for the church age believer, that begins at his enthronement. When he was begotten from the dead and resurrection, he's enthroned. And that's when, through the Holy Spirit, beginning at Pentecost, the Son is given to us. God gives us himself in the person of his Son. And the government will rest on his shoulders. That's looking at the millennial promises of Jesus Christ from a Jewish perspective. But that government we see resting on his shoulders, it began to be extended and expressed through the book of Acts. When Jesus, as he is being proclaimed, and when he is released to the Holy Spirit, then we see believers are added to the church, believers are added to the Lord. We saw that in Acts. We saw the word added. Christ himself begins to have an extension. We see that promise in John 12. Unless a grain of wheat falls in the ground, it remains alone. But if it falls in the ground, it dies, and it bears much fruit. And so in the bearing of that fruit, the seed, Isaiah 53, verse 10 and following, he shall see his seed and prolong his days, and the government of the Lord will be upon his hand. The hand of the Lord will be upon him. So we see that in the prophecy of Isaiah, he shall see his seed. That began to take on a reality in the book of Acts. That was unknown in the Old Testament. There was no paradigm. There was no particular specificity as to how that would be understood. And that mystery was revealed to Paul. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, when he's describing the body of the Christ, he's talking about the various gifts and their working under the ministry of the Holy Spirit, that each one, that is the varieties of gifts in 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 6, is given for the common good of all. Verse 11, but one and the same Spirit works, that is, energizes, is supernaturally operational in all things, distributing, present tense, to each member of Christ individually just as he wills. So God determines how the various gifts function in locality and on a corporate level. For even as the body, the illustration being the human body, is one, and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, that is the human body, though they are many, are one body, so also is the Christ. And in the Greek, the definite article is there, the Christ. For by one Spirit were we all baptized, incorporated, identified with and brought into this oneness of union, into this one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we're all made to drink of one spirit, for the body is not one member, but many. This is a basic definition of the organic nature of the Christ. Head, but collectively, the members of the body represent the Christ. The majority of those members are in heaven right now, but we're still joined with them. In other words, we're not separated from the Apostle Paul organically. In our spirit, we're not. We know from 1 Corinthians 6:17, 18, I think, it says, the one who is joined with the Lord is one spirit. Well, that joining, that union, remains after death. That is not broken. Notice the phraseology, the wording in Hebrews chapter 12. It says, you have not come to Mount Sinai, with reference to the Old Covenant, but you have come to the Church of the Living God, to the spirits of just men made perfect. You have come. Perfect tense. You have come. We are one with all those that have preceded us. The body is still one, even though physically there are those who have departed and there are those that are still here on earth. The body remains one. It cannot be divided. And the body will be one at the rapture. There will be no partial rapture. When Jesus returns, the dead in Christ, that means all who died, not just the overcomers, will rise first. Then we who are alive and survive, as that surviving remnant, shall be caught up together with them, amasun, at the same time. Why? Because the body cannot be divided. When the church is resurrected, it will be a unified resurrection, not a series of staged resurrections. Okay? It's about the unity of the body. So those who teach partial rapture, they actually miss the fact that if one member of the body is raised from the dead, it demands that every other member is raised at the same time. That passage in 1 Thessalonians. We shall be caught up together with them. Together with them. Amasun. Together, literally, at the same time. Same time. That's very, very important. Otherwise, you have a blending of the eschatology of Israel in the Gospels, and you try to integrate that with the specific revelation of the church in Thessalonians, and you try to create an amalgamated eschatology, which causes confusion. The last thing that we're going to look at before we actually move forward from where we left off last time is the passage that has already been cited, Colossians 1 and verse 25. Concerning the church, I was made a minister according to the stewardship, that is, that dispensation which has been committed to me from God, bestowed on me for your benefit, that I might bring to fullness the word of God. So the word of God in that revelation would come to fullness, namely the sacred secret, the mysterion, verse 26, which has been hidden from past ages and generations, but has now been manifested to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of this mysterion, this sacred secret, among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, plural. You all, the hope of the glory. The hope of the glory. Glory, of course, is a manifestation of the nature of God as light. And we're going to be picking up on that as we continue on looking from the scripture, the revelation of the mystery of the Christ. So we're going to be looking at today on the process which is now occurring between Pentecost and the rapture. Formation, constitution, and revelation. Formation, constitution, revelation. This is the goal of the person of the Holy Spirit, to form, to constitute us according to Christ, that he might be revealed and therefore manifest. It's the revelation that produces the manifestation. The number one priority of the third person of the Trinity in each one of our lives is that process where Christ is formed in us. Begin to see some of the nuances and some of the facets of this mystery, which was deposited primarily with Paul, and he became the revelator, the one who proclaimed the mystery of Christ, as we notice already in Romans 16, 25 and 26 and other passages. We'll just begin by noting an incident from the book of Acts, which is really somewhat shocking and remarkable when you think of the implications. For a Jewish person to actually hear what Paul said here, they would attribute Paul as a heretic. That this is what Paul is saying. He's taken the word of God out of context. This is not even possible. What we're going to read in the Jewish mind would be completely outside their capability of comprehending what he's saying here. And we'll see in a moment. Here he is at Antioch with Paul and Barnabas, meeting in the synagogues there. Acts 13, verse 44. And the next Sabbath day, the whole city assembled to hear the word of God. But when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and began contradicting the things spoken by Paul and were blaspheming. Now, it's very interesting if you read Acts. Paul literally argued them down from the scriptures. It's a strong term. I think it's katalogo. He just literally argued them down. He took the word of God and they had no way of escaping it. And so they would just persecute, try to kill him, because they could not defeat him in terms of scriptural logic, and the power of the Holy Spirit was on him. Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, that is, with openness and freedom, and said, it was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first, the Jews, verse 45, and since you repudiate it and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life, behold, we are turning to the Gentiles. Something what Paul said three different times in the book of Acts, okay? It's rather humorous in a way. Three times he said, we're turning to the Gentiles as a result of the recalcitrant and stiff-necked heart of the Jews. For thus the Lord has commanded us. Notice the subject. The Lord has commanded us. And what does Paul do? He quotes from Isaiah. We'll notice the passages in a moment. Thus, he's commanded us, I have appointed you, which would be the plural, as a light for the Gentiles, that you should bring salvation to the end of the earth. The Jews would understand this prophecy. They would understand this prophecy. You would be the nation of Israel, that when Israel is exalted as the head of the nations, then they would once fulfill their prophetic role among the nations as a light to the Gentiles. If you look at Exodus 19 and verses 5 and 6, you are a holy nation, a holy priesthood, to proclaim my name. Israel was chosen to be a kingdom of priests among the nations. And they forfeited that capacity when they rejected Jesus Christ at the first advent. And so that is held in suspension until the fullness of the Gentiles come in, and then all Israel will be saved. We see that in Romans 11. So notice, Paul is saying the Lord commanded us, and then he cites from Isaiah 49:6. But we're going to begin by looking at Isaiah 42, because the theme is there. So we're looking at this that was taken from the prophetic scriptures. Remember, the church age is a mystery. They know nothing of a parenthesis between what we now see. There's the first coming of Christ, the suffering Savior, the second coming of Christ, a victorious Savior that comes to deliver Israel. One is the suffering servant according to Joseph, a messianic figure according to Joseph, and then one according to the seed of David, a victorious king. That's all they knew. They just saw that together. They could not understand how he could be a suffering Savior, would be a sacrifice for sins, and also coming as a reigning king to deliver Israel. They saw that in the scriptures, juxtaposed, only separated by a vav, a conjunction. But they couldn't see a prophetic parenthesis there, because that, explained by Paul, is the partial hardening of Israel has opened up an opportunity for the Lord to reach out to the Gentiles independent of Israel. In other words, that was not prophesied in terms of what the Jews expected. We'll just begin reading from Isaiah 42. Behold my servant. In Isaiah, this genre, the servant, the theme of the servant, you have Messiah as servant, you have Israel corporately as a servant, and of course Isaiah functions as a servant. You have different layering of the servant. If you want to look at verse 18, hear you deaf, and look you blind, that you may see who is blind but my servant, or so deaf as my messenger whom I send. He's referring to Israel. Among the nations, they were to be his servant. Well, we look back at verse 1 of chapter 42. This is servant par excellence. This is the servant. This is Yahweh in the flesh, Jesus. Behold, my servant, whom I uphold. It's prophecy of the Lord Jesus. My chosen one, my elect one, whom my soul delights. So this is the prophetic designation in Isaiah, one of the many, of Jesus. I have put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the nations. Well, that's a second advent and 1,000-year reign of Christ. That's still unfulfilled. He hasn't brought forth justice to the nations yet. Look at the nations now. They're in turmoil. We see there it's a raging storm. He will not cry out or raise his voice, nor make his voice heard in the street. First advent. A bruised reed he will not break. A dimly burning wick he will not extinguish. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not be disheartened or discouraged or crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands will wait expectantly for his law. That's a second advent fulfillment. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and its offspring, who gives breath to the people on it, and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord, I am Yahweh, I have called you, the Messiah, my servant, in righteousness. I will also hold you by the hand and watch over you, and I will appoint you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the nations. When Jesus came, he claimed to be the light. But he came first to be a light to the Jewish people. But to become a light to the nations, that didn't even begin until Acts chapter 10. There were some Gentiles saved, but they were just on the periphery. They were basically exceptions that we notice in Matthew 10 and Matthew 15, which we've already looked at. You, Messiah, will be a covenant to the people and a light to the nations, to open blind eyes, to bring prisoners from the dungeon, and those who dwell in darkness from the prison. Now we'll see this same theme when Jesus appoints Paul to be this very thing, being identified with the Messiah to carry out this exact same function. There is a merging of the identity of the body of Christ with the Christ. And that merger of that identity got Paul in big trouble. The Jews were just very, very upset. They thought he was robbing Israel of their prophetic role among the nations and distorting the scriptures. They thought he was a deceiver. The Messiah is going to open blind eyes to bring prisoners out from the dungeon and those who dwell in darkness from the prison. That's what he began to do, as we're going to see from the prophets of Isaiah at the first advent, that even Matthew and Luke interpret this role as it pertains to Messiah in his first advent, and we see later on it pertains to the role and function of Messiah when he comes at the second advent. I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not give my glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. In the Septuagint, another is heteros, something of a different nature, another category or kind. And yet in John 17, Father, the glory you have given me, I've given to them. We're not in this another. There's no revelation that God would give his glory to Israel in the way he's given to the church. In 2 Thessalonians 2:14, we have been called to gain possession of the glory of Jesus Christ. We've been called. It's referred to as the on high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Behold, the former things have come to pass. Now I declare new things. Before they spring forth, I proclaim them to you. And then the passage in Isaiah 49 is another messianic prophecy that the Jews would understand and would anticipate as their coming Messiah. Listen to me, O islands. This would refer to those Gentile nations, of which Israel is the center of the nations. Ezekiel 5:5. Israel is the center of the nations. Pay attention, you peoples from afar, again the Gentiles. The Lord called me from the womb. This is Jesus. From the body of my mother he named me. His name shall be called Jesus, Yeshua, for he shall save his people from their sins. That's a prophecy. He has made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand he has concealed me. The incarnation, Isaiah 53, we did not esteem him as anything special or unique among mankind. He's concealed me. He has also made me a select arrow. He has hidden me in his quiver. In the incarnation, Philippians 2, 5 through 8, he was in a state of kenosis, humiliation. So that quiver is a humanity that's like us, only is sinless. And in that quiver of that humanity, we see in Isaiah 53, the nation of Israel completely missed their Messiah. They rejected him. This arrow, this weapon of God that he's going to use in the day of the Lord for the destruction and the overflow of all that which opposes the kingdom of God, it's an arrow waiting to be released. But that select arrow began to be released at Pentecost when Jesus Christ in the person of the Holy Spirit, when he comes forth as the living word of God proclaimed, that arrow pierced hearts and the fullness of the Gentiles began to come in and to become a part of the body of Christ. And he, the Father, said to me, Messiah, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will show my glory. Israel as a nation was called to show the glory of God, but as a nation they failed. Who's the ideal Israel? Who's the ideal prince with God? That's Messiah. Jesus is the Israel. He's the ideal Israel. And then the nation was to be identified with him and to express who he is among the nations. They failed. And they were temporarily set aside for the dispensation. Israel, here's a title. And those who have read Sparks, he has a number of messages on the church as being spiritual Israel. He gets himself in trouble because he sounds like a replacement theology, that the church has replaced Israel and there's no future for Israel. He's never said that. He always qualifies that, but not always in all contexts, which I think is a vulnerability that he has. But he said, for the dispensation, we are that spiritual Israel. And that's the very language we see in 1 Peter chapter 2. He quotes passages that pertain to Israel, and he now applies them to the church. That is, the Holy Spirit speaking through Peter. In reality, the church is spiritual Israel in this dispensation and has replaced Israel as the ambassador to the nations for the dispensation. But when Jesus returns, Israel will be exalted as the head of the nations. It's going to happen. God's promise to Israel, we see from Jeremiah 29, 30, and 31, that God's covenant with Israel cannot be broken. It's established as sure as fixed as the universe, the sun and the moon are fixed in their orbits. You cannot change that, therefore my covenant with Israel cannot be broken. So when God fulfills his covenant promise to Israel, they will be the head of the nations. But something has to happen first. Because God, we see from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 40, God having something better for us, church age believers, in order that they, Old Testament saints, cannot reach perfection apart from us. And so that perfection is the perfecting of Christ being formed and constituted in members of his body. The Messiah said when he comes, we see in Isaiah 53, he comes to a nation, he came to his own received him not. In Isaiah 53, he's like a seed coming out of parched ground. Jesus, in his humanity, I have toiled in vain, Isaiah 49:4. I've spent my strength for nothing in vanity. So in his humanity, he's not falling, he's not sinning. From in that humanity, he had to go through an experience emotionally as a person. When it says he came to his own, and that's neuter, his own nation, and his own, that his own people did not receive him, but to as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God, even those who believe in his name, John 1:11 and 12. In his humanity, it looked like a failed mission. I have toiled in vain, I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity, purposelessness. Yet surely the justice, that is the vindication due to me, is with the Lord, that is Jehovah the Father. And my, the reward of Messiah, and his faithfulness to the Father in his first advent ministry, my reward is with my God. Speaking from his humanity. And now says the Lord, Jehovah the Father, who formed me, the Messiah, Jehovah the Son, from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, in order that Israel might be gathered to him. Now that has never happened. That was the purpose of the first advent, and as a nation they said no. But it will be fulfilled. We see in Zechariah 12, the spirit of supplication and repentance shall come upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem and those of the descendants of David, and they're going to repent. But repentance is going to begin right there in Jerusalem and with the descendants of David in the future. And that will lead to a revival and prepare that remnant for the second coming of Jesus Christ to deliver Israel. He's going to bring back Jacob, Israel, might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the sight of the Lord, that is God the Father, and my God is my strength. This is the humanity of Jesus. My God is my strength. We can't be any less. This has to be true of us as well. He says, is it too small a thing that you should be my servant? The Father says to him, to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel, the remnant. I will also make you, God the Father, speaking of Jesus Christ, I will make you a light of the nations. This is the very verse that Paul cites in Acts chapter 13, verse 47, when the Lord said to us, as he's speaking to the Jews, I've made you to be a light to the nations. Do you get that? God the Father is speaking of Jesus Christ here, and now Jesus Christ commissions Paul, you are to be me to the nations. Well, how can that be? As the Messiah, as members of the Christ, we are to be living, organic manifestations and expressions of the Messiah. That's evangelism. That is the revelation of the Messiah. I will make you, Father speaking to Jesus, a light to the nations. The first advent had its beginning. There was no fulfillment of that in the first advent. Beginning with the book of Acts, that light through members of his body begin to be released. Tarry in Jerusalem till you're clothed with the power on high, for you shall be witnesses first here in Jerusalem, and then Judea, then Samaria, and the othermost parts of the earth. You see the progression. I'll make you a light of the nations, so that my salvation may reach the end of the earth. So that beginning of the book of Acts, that is still in progress as of today. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and its Holy One, to the despised one, to the abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers, kings shall see and arise, second advent. Princes shall bow down, because the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, has chosen you, Jesus, as the Messiah. Notice also in Isaiah 9, this is a prophecy of the first advent of Jesus Christ that had its fulfillment during that period of history. Remember, Jesus had much of his ministry in the area of Galilee. Isaiah 9, but there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, that is in the north, with contempt. But later on, he shall make it glorious by the way of the sea on the other side of Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. He'll make it glorious how? He's going to send Messiah. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light, and those who live in a dark land, the light will shine upon them. The light will shine upon them. And we see from Matthew chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, this passage is cited with reference to the first advent ministry of Jesus Christ. This is actually fulfilled in the person of the Messiah. Notice a few statements from Luke, and we'll just walk through scriptures as we see these Old Testament scriptures as it pertains to Messiah, fulfilled in the person of Christ, and then in the person of the Holy Spirit, how this is extended through the baptism of the Holy Spirit into Christ. Christ is baptized into us through the person of the Holy Spirit. Then that formation of the Christ begins from Pentecost onward. And when that formation reaches a level of fullness, the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, then the fullness of God will have an extension in the body and bride of Christ, which is the fullness of him, because that fullness is already in the head in the person of Jesus Christ. We will be looking at that later on, that there first has to be the fullness of God in the man Christ Jesus, and then that fullness is to be extended and come to maturation and fullness in the body of Christ corporate before the end comes. It is so intricate and is so specific. Just think, every member of the body of Christ throughout history, everyone is completely unique, and everyone has a free will, and the Holy Spirit has to nuance every little detail in our circumstances so that he can find a way for Christ to be formed in each circumstance in such a way that this composite Christ, made up of many members, the complement, when the body and bride of Christ complement the fullness in the head, there'll be a rapture, because we know from Ephesians 1:23, the church which is his body is the fullness of him. It's the complement. It completes him. He's not complete. God the Father is completing him personally, but in terms of the Christ mission, who he is as the Christ, he's not yet complete, because the Christ doesn't have a bride. The bride is the fullness of him who fills all in all. Think about the infinite wisdom for the Holy Spirit to sculpt and to so work in each individual life that every member is interrelated, interdependent, and interconnected with the head. As this body is growing and expanding, ultimately, to be the fullness of him. And who is him? The one in whom all the fullness of the Godhead is already at home bodily. These are the key thoughts and revelation of what the mystery is. Luke 1, we have Zacharias, and we've read this in the past because we see him saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel." He sees that John the Baptist is coming to fulfill his mission to prepare a way for the Lord as prophesied. And we see verse 76, "You will go before the Lord to prepare his ways." That's Zacharias speaking of his son, John the Baptist. Verse 77, "Give his people the knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins because of the tender mercy of our God. With the sunrise, the Anatole from on high shall visit us." Out from the source of on high shall visit us. The sunrise. Jesus is the shoot and the day star. He's the offspring of David, and he is the glory of David in his second advent as king. The term there refers to both shoot and star. It's what's called a double entendre, onontole. We've looked at this before, the word sunrise. Shall visit us. So that's First Advent. Notice, to shine upon those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. That's the fulfillment of Isaiah 9, 1 and 2, and again in Matthew 4, 16, where that verse is cited again, with reference to the First Advent ministry of Jesus Christ. This is individual. We look at Luke 2 and verse 27. Here's Simeon, as he is waiting in his old age. He's looking for the consolation of Israel, verse 25. The Holy Spirit was upon him. And verse 26, revealed to Simeon by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he saw the Lord's Messiah, the Lord's Christ. And yet, head and body were called the Christ. No one in the Gospels knew anything about this. This is still a secret. Even all the way up to the resurrection of Jesus Christ in the book of Acts, it was not even known to Peter. When Peter stood up and preached to all the house of Israel, he didn't even know yet. He didn't know. It wasn't until Israel, in Acts chapter 7, as they became unified right at the Sanhedrin and the stoning of Stephen, did that revelation begin with the salvation of Paul. We see that progressively in the book of Acts. Notice, verse 28, Simeon took Jesus in his arms as an infant and blessed God, and he said, "Now, Lord, thou dost let thy bondservant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation." Salvation is a person, which thou hast prepared in the presence of all the peoples, notice, a light of revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. A light of revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. There again, Isaiah 42:6. Isaiah 49, 6, and then the passage we saw in Acts 13, verse 47. The Lord said to me, Paul, I shall make you a messianic embodiment and testimony as a person to the nations. Something's happened. The Lord has taken that Old Testament scripture that pertains to himself and says, now, Paul, that's you. You who are fulfilling the missionary call to which I have assigned you, beginning there at Antioch in Acts chapter 10. And this is the heart of the gospel, that when Paul says the revelation of the mystery according to my gospel, this was given to me uniquely. And he says so in a number of places, in Galatians chapter 1 as well. Without this, if we don't understand this, even when we're witnessing to someone, the gospel is the power of God and the salvation. We just speak. We don't have any feeling. We just faithful to the word, and Christ is preaching. When we preach, he's preaching. We give the gospel, he's giving the gospel. So do you understand the opportunity? Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? Would you like to know what it means to be saved so that if you die today, you're going to be in heaven? He's inviting you to come to him so he can save you from your sins and make you a member of his body so you can be one with him in God. Christ preaches through members of his body. Acts chapter 1, all the things Jesus began to do and teach. If you finish that statement out in Acts, he continued to do and teach in the person of the Holy Spirit through the apostles and through the body of Christ throughout the book of Acts and all the way up to the present. He continued. It's still him, Christ, in the person of his other self, John 14, the Holy Spirit. John 1, the Logos, in relation to the Trinity and the Godhead. John 1:3, all things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing has come into being that has come into being. In him was, ever was, the life. He's the ultimate life source. And the life was the light of men. When God created Adam, that life that was in him, that was breathed into him at his creation, was the source of light and illumination. When he sinned, the life went out. And the light turned off. And Adam and his race were plunged into darkness. And the light, John says in 80 to 90 AD, the light right now is shining in the darkness. How? He's in heaven, but that light is shining in members of his body. That light right now, after the resurrection and ascension, John says, this is his testimony, this was written between 80 and 95 AD, that light right now is shining in the darkness. And the darkness did not comprehend it or overpower it. That light is shining. And we see that in his epistles. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. And if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. 1 John 1:5. And then in John 8, This is individual. This is the Christ on an individual level, and this is who he is in the incarnation, personally, as the Christ. John 8:12. Again, therefore, Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am. This is one of the seven or so I am statements of Jesus. I am the light of the world, not just of Israel, but the whole world. He who, present tense, goes on following me shall not walk in the darkness, but shall have the light of life. The appositional accusative here is shall have the light, the life. That's all the Greek says. Shall have the light, the life. How do you understand that? Well, you shall have the light that originates and has its source and is a manifestation of the life. There's light, which is intellectual knowledge, and then there's light, which originates from life. And that's how we were designed by God. All illumination, all knowing is to spring from life. Any knowing or knowledge that's separate from the life, it may be true, but it's just knowledge. In fact, in its function, it's the letter, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. It's just the letter. That all revelation, even scripture, we must go through what is written and say, Lord, this is revelation. I believe this is your word, but I need to have this revelation coming to me from you as the source of life. The light has its origin and is generated from who he is as the life. The light of life. Read more about that in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Tremendous. Then John 12:35, speaking to his disciples in the upper room there. In John 12:35, Jesus therefore said to them, Judas is still there. He's not in the upper room yet, beginning with 13, as they prepare for the Passover. He said to them, for a little while longer, the light is among you. That is the revelation of God in the man Christ Jesus. The light. God is light. The light is among you. Walk while you have the light. Order your life, that darkness may not overtake you. He who walks in the darkness does not know where he goes. While you have the light, go on believing in the light in order that you may become sons of light. Sons of, whenever you have sons of, this is a Semitism, it's a Hebraism. Sons of light means sons are characterized by light. A son of light means when you look at this person, they are characterized as light. Sons of light. In other words, they have the nature and bearing of Christ himself. Sons of light. That's who we're to become. In fact, in the war scroll of the Dead Sea Scrolls, you have an account of the war between the sons of light and the sons of Belial or darkness. It's in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And they depict this final war before Messiah comes between the sons of light and the sons of darkness. Let's move over to the epistles now. Let's notice in Ephesians 5 how this revelation is now a corporate reality, and the darkness is described. That same theme is going to be mentioned right here in Ephesians. We'll start with chapter 4. The body is to be built up until it attains the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, building itself up in love, as through every joint is supply, Ephesians 4:16. Verse 17, this I say and affirm, that is, I solemnly testify together with the Lord. What I'm saying, I'm one with the Lord on this, this is like thus saith the Lord. That you walk, you conduct your life, no longer as the Gentiles walk or conduct their life in the futility, the emptiness, and the purposelessness of their mind. Everyone who's coming out of the background of SRIDID is completely immersed in this culture. It's futility. Whatever you're seeking, you never get. You never have. Whatever you have, it's gone. Notice, perfect tense, being brought to a state and condition of darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God. Therefore, the light that originates from the life of God is darkness. Because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness, the petrification of their heart. And they, having become callous, lose all sensitivity, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with asalgeia, a greediness that seeks to exploit that other person for the satisfaction of their own self-centered carnal lusts. But you did not learn the Messiah in this way. You're members of the Messiah. It doesn't say you did not learn about the Messiah. come unto me and learn from me, Matthew 11. That's in the context of the Old Covenant. This is an upstep. This is an upgrade. Instead of learning from me, Matthew 11, when we're members of Christ, then we go from learning from me or about me as a disciple to learning him. That's different. That's an upgrade. You did not learn the Messiah in this way. You did not learn the Messiah in this way. If indeed you have heard him, not about him, you can have the letter of the law and hear about him, but actually heard him and have been taught, listen, in him. He's the sphere in which you've been taught. In, locative of sphere, locative, in him, just as truth is in Jesus. But in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old Adamic self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit, and that you go on allowing yourself to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Not just in your mind, but the mind subordinated to the spirit. The mind that has gone through death, the aspect of that soul has gone through death and has come out in resurrection. And now the spirit, the human spirit in union with the Holy Spirit, governs the mind. And you put on the new man, which, according to God, literally, that which is in conformity to God has been created, this new man, in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Chapter 5, verse 3. Do not let immorality, that's sexual immorality, or any impurity or greed, this all has to do with sexual sin, even be named among you as is proper among saints, and there must be no filthiness or silly talk, that would be sexual talk that has innuendo in it, in this context, or coarse jesting, joking around, through innuendo, that which has a sexual undertone to it, which is not fitting, but rather giving thanks. For this you know with certainty that no immoral, sexually active person outside of marriage, that's what it is, someone involved sexually outside of marriage, or impure person, or covetous man, who is an idolater, has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ or God. Remember, he's talking to beloved children, chapter 5, verse 1. So it's about inheritance. The Corinthians were saved. 1 Corinthians 1, 2. But we know from 1 Corinthians 6 that they were involved with things that would result in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that at the Bema Seat they would be saved so as through fire. Their whole life will go up in smoke. Their spirit is saved, but there's no inheritance. So this is about inheritance. Our conduct involves inheritance. Let no one deceive you with empty words. Who is he talking to? Beloved children, verse 1. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience, those sons who are characterized by disobedience. Therefore, Christians, do not be partakers with them. Well, he wouldn't say that if it wasn't possible. The Corinthians were partakers of that. The Nicolaitans in Revelation 2 were partakers of that. For you, notice, you were not formerly in darkness, but you, constitutionally, you were darkness. But now you are light in the Lord. He is the light of the world. Now you in him are light. Walk, order, and conduct your behavior as children of light. For the fruit of light consists in agathosune, that would be an active generosity, righteousness, that is that which conforms the revealed will of God in thought, word, and deed, and truth, that is reality as God defines reality, trying or proving what is pleasing to the Lord, and do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness. Instead, reprove and expose them, for it is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. And so we just had, after 30 years, someone who went out and participated in an unfruitful deed of darkness, after 30 years in our midst. Is there any excuse for that? Well, that's because of DID? No. It's not because of DID. You can't be here for 30 years and then go out to a ritual and be involved in darkness, unless there's something in that person that's not repentant. Period. We don't nuance this. It is disgraceful to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. Notice, the kingdom of darkness, the coward that Satan is, he is such a coward, and those who follow Satan are all cowards and deceived, because Satan is not omnipotent. The coward that he is, he always has to do things under cover of darkness. Go to rituals at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. The coward cannot operate effectively in the light. He's disabled. Our enemy is a coward. But he's a belligerent tyrant to those that do not know their position in Christ and our authority in Christ. The saints that know their authority in Christ are not cowards, and Satan is afraid of them. Satan has fear. But all things become visible, as they become manifest, when they are exposed, reproved by the light. By who we are as walking the light, will expose that. So whatever degree that we have not been fully in the light, there has not been that exposure. I look at my own life. Whatever degree I have not been in the light, then that light has not had enough impact in our midst. Holiness is power. Holiness is authority. Holiness is life. Where there's a lack of holiness, there's a lack of life, there's a lack of power, there's a lack of authority. So how committed are we to holiness, you see? All things become visible when they're exposed by the light. For everything that becomes visible, that becomes manifest, is light. It bears the nature of God. Light is the manifestation of the divine nature. Light. Nature of God. Manifest. For this reason, it says, Christians, awake, sleeper. If you're a Christian and not walking in the light, you're asleep. Romans 11, awake. It's time for you to awake from sleep. Paul's addressing Christians in Romans 13, 11. Knowing this, the time that is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep, for now final salvation is nearer to us than when we believed. Romans 13, 12. The night is almost gone, the day is at hand. Let us therefore lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. To be walking in the divine nature is armor. It protects us. Holiness is our protection. Let us behave properly as in the day, not in carousing. That would be drunken orgies and drunkenness and sexual promiscuity and sensuality. Not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ. You'll never find a commandment like that in the Ten Commandments. You'll never hear God speaking to Moses, put on the Messiah. You'll never find anywhere in the Old Testament where God commands His covenant people to put on the Messiah. This is the core of the mystery. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision, give no forethought to the old Adamic nature, the flesh, with regard to its lusts. So awake, sleeper, Ephesians 5:14, Christian sleeper, arise from the dead. This is not a born-again rising of the dead. The Holy Spirit can take this and use it to evangelize. I understand that. That would be an application, but the interpretation is for Christians. This would be for Laodiceans, arise from the dead. For those at Thyatira, in your carnality, arise from the dead. For those at Sardis, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Oh, wait a minute. Christ will shine on you. Where's that coming from? That is a prophecy. That's an allusion to a prophecy in Isaiah 60, 1 through 3, with reference to what we now know is the second coming of Jesus Christ. When Jesus returns, the light of the Messiah will shine upon Israel. And yet we have a harbinger, that which is anticipatory, that's to take place in the church first. Isaiah 60, 1 through 3 is waiting to be fulfilled. It's contingent upon this. Is the whole church going to wake up before the coming of Jesus Christ of the rapture? No. That's why we see in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25 through 29, a great shaking is going to come to shake that which can be shaken as of created things, in order that that which cannot be shaken might remain. The nature of Christ, the character of God, the kingdom of God. That shaking is coming. It shook the earth then in 70 AD, and there's a promise it's going to happen again at the end. There's going to be a mighty shaking, and I believe it's going to be connected with disclosure. I believe disclosure will actually come that will cause a great falling away. The disclosure will come and say that basically we were seeded by these aliens that brought us from Homo erectus to Homo sapien, and now at this critical juncture in history, Homo sapien is reaching the point of dying out. We need an upgrade in order to attain singularity, and Homo sapien 2.0, where they're going to come again and help us move forward in our evolutionary process to become God-men. There'll be people who fall away. 2 Thessalonians 2, the disclosure. It's a massive false flag. And they're going to be real craft. And like Brother Marzulli says, rebuke first and ask questions later. If an F-15 flies over and you rebuke it, is it going to stop flying? It's going to keep flying. If an F-15 comes over and drops bombs, you're going to rebuke the bombs? Nothing's going to happen. And these craft are physical, and you rebuke these craft. And they're not just entities that are going in and out of dimensions. These craft are interdimensional, but that's physics. And they have the physics. And so when these craft appear, some of these orbs are fallen angels. but not all of the UFOs are manifestations of fallen angels. They're a physical craft made right here, deep underground skunk works, black projects, financed by trillions of dollars a year that is not even under the jurisdiction of Congress. This is all documented by Michael Schratt, the aviation historian, Michael Schratt, S-C-H-R-A-T-T. He's not a Christian, but he's documented these black budget projects. And there are levels of security that are way beyond the president. It's all fact. Dr. Paul LaViolette, the physicist, there is electrogravitic craft that has been in operation since post-Nazi Germany. It's evolved. I've seen videos of craft in Afghanistan. These TR-B, skunkwork, triangular craft, electrogravitic, firing laser-type weapons and blowing things up in Afghanistan. They're actual craft. It's coming. Deception is coming. There is that which we see history moving towards. It's moving towards a culmination, and that is the church coming, the measure of stature, the fullness of Christ. In that context, there's going to be a disclosure, and the rapture is a deliverance. It's a salvation. 2 Thessalonians 2:13 and 14, it's a salvation. In that context, there's going to be a great falling away, and a remnant is going to be raptured. And those who are alive, namely the surviving remnant, shall be called to meet the Lord in the air. And I've taught on this in the past. The word remain is clearly a remnant term, and that is found under the heading of lema in volume 4 of Kittle's Theological Dictionary of the New Testament. Lema, and there are a number of terms for remnant. Katalema, hupolema is used for the Jewish remnant in the Pauline writings in Romans, but perilema or perilepomai is used specifically for the rapture remnant. It's very, very clear. The Holy Spirit is very meticulous and precise in distinguishing terms. You're not seen in translation, but in the original it's clear. By the way, the doctrine of inspiration, this is just by the way, that scriptures is the inspired word of God in its original autographs. That's the orthodox definition of inspiration. It's the inspired word of God in its original Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. That means any translator, to be true to that, there's never a word for word translation, but it represents the truth of what's in the original. And ESV has done a good job. I use the New American Standard. The Amplified has done a good job. There are certain areas that can only be explained through exegesis, that is, the bringing out from the original. So we have good translations. I read from the New American. It's an excellent translation, from both the Hebrew and the Greek. But in order to have the fullness, then it's important to refer to the original so you can get an expansion of what is a good translation. That's what exegesis is, okay? When it comes to the inheritance, we have to be children of light. We have to be sons of light. We have to be walking in the light. So that that divine nature, which is defined by light, and that light originates from the life of God, which is eternal life, that is the character of God's life, the nature of God's life, it does not operate or have any affinity or identity with anything in darkness, and the darkness is that which is completely outside and contrary to light. The flesh, what we are by nature in Adam, not only sinful flesh, but the most righteous, good flesh, is dead to God. It's dead. In other words, the best of what we would call the psychikos, the natural man in Adam, God is not there. He's not in the good and the best of man, altruism, philanthropy. He's not there. The only good is in the resurrected and glorified Jesus Christ. Every other good, it can have its place. It can have its role and function and establishment, but it has no eternal value when it comes to who Christ is. All good comes out from the source of Christ. Active, general goodness, in Ephesians 5:9, comes from Christ, who alone, as man glorified, is the source of all good, the source of all life. How is this fulfilled in our lives? In other words, if we are to become light in the Lord, if we are to be walking in the light and thus coming into the inheritance, which is contingent upon walking in the light, how is this fulfilled in our lives? So we're going to just take a little walk through scriptures and just notice some principles. John the Baptist was the herald of the Messiah. We know from Isaiah 40, verses 1 through 6 or so, and Malachi chapter 3. We see the promise of John the Baptist, who was the one who prepared the way of the Lord, Luke 1, 15 through 17. He came to prepare the way of the Lord by getting a people ready for the Lord. How is he, as the forerunner of the Messiah, as the last Old Testament saint and prophet before the church age began, how is he described in terms of his ministry? Well, in John chapter 3, John had not yet been thrown in prison, John 3:24. In verse 25, therefore there arose a discussion on the part of John's disciples with a Jew about purification. And they came to John and they said to him, Rabbi, teacher, he who was with you beyond the Jordan, to whom you have become witness, behold, he is baptizing and all are coming to him. And John answered and said, a man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from heaven. Although Jesus wasn't baptizing, but there were those that were becoming disciples of Jesus. And so John responds, there can be nothing given to him unless it has been given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness that I said I am not the Messiah, but I have been sent before him. I'm a forerunner. He who has the bride is the bridegroom. That's a mystery. Nobody knows where the bride is or who it is. The bride is hidden in the side of Jesus, ready to be pierced on the cross. Okay? But the friend of the bridegroom, in this case John the Baptist, who stands and hears him, rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This joy of mine has been made full. He must increase, but I must decrease. Literally, he must grow, and I must decrease, be made less and inferior. He who comes from above is above all, and he who is of the earth is of the earth and speaks of the earth, and he who comes from heaven is above all. John is completing his course. Luke 1:80. He completed his course. He finished. And that prepared the way for the church age. He didn't even know. He prepared the way for the Messiah, but in a deeper and more profound sense, he's preparing for the mystery of the Christ. If you look at John chapter 5, Jesus speaking of his relation to the Father and the role of John the Baptist as the forerunner of the Messiah, in John 5, verse 33, you have sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth, verse 33, verse 34, but the witness which I receive is not from man, but I say these things that you may be saved. So the Father witnesses to him through the Holy Spirit. He, John, was a lamp, that which bore light, that was burning and was shining, and you were willing to rejoice for a while in his light. He made it very clear in John chapter 1 that he is not the light. He'd just come to bear witness to the light. But the witness which I have is greater than that of John, for the works which the Father has given me to accomplish, that is, bring to a goal, the very works I do bear witness to me that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me has borne witness of me. You have neither heard his voice at any time or seen his form. How do we come into the reality of the Christ? How is he to be formed? How are we to be constituted? How do we become the revelation of the Christ? Jesus told Paul, I have sent you to be a light to the nations, to be a messianic representation to the nations, to be a Christian, a Christ one, an anointed one. Well, a burning, what happens if you're burning? You're being consumed. The cross is at work. We are decreasing, burning, in order he might increase, grow, shining. They're directly related. John 3:30 compared to John 5:35. Decrease, burning, shining, increase. You were willing to rejoice for a while in his life. So that's a process. The fire is the divine nature in the person the Holy Spirit in us. Remember, Hebrews 12:29, our God is an all-consuming fire. In moral and spiritual terms, God is a consuming fire, will touch everything in your life and mine that's still naturally rooted in Adam, whether it's sinful Adam or self-righteous, soul-governed Adam. The fire will touch it. And we should rejoice in that. It's very unpleasant. There's no pleasure to the flesh for the cross to work in our lives. That's the pathway to the inheritance. 2 Corinthians 4:6, this principle is very clearly seen in many ways. We could look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 through 11. We see the principle working there. We see the principle working in 2 Corinthians 2:14. When Paul says, thanks be to God who always leads us in his triumph in Christ and manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him in every place, for we are a fragrance of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing, to one aroma from death to death and the other aroma of life to life, and who is adequate for these things? aroma of life to life. As Paul goes into death, life is released, and that aroma is released. But the victory, thanks be to God who leads us in his triumphal procession. This word triumph is only found in one other place, and that is in Colossians 2:15, where on the cross, God the Father stripped off principalities and powers and made a public display of them in the triumph of Christ on that cross. It's a victorious triumph. It's a victorious triumph. When Paul says here, thanks be to God who leads us in his triumph, what does that mean? That I feel victory? No, Paul's saying, in my experience, this doesn't look like victory. It looks like death. We're going to see here in a minute. The triumph of Christ in the natural looks like death because Christ is triumphing over us. For God to lead us in his triumph means something in us is being removed progressively to make a place for him, for us to be constituted, for him to be formed, constituted, and ultimately revealed in us. And God is very strictly adhering to this protocol, that there is a death that is working in us so that life through ministry can be released in others. Thanks be to God who leads us in. It's in his triumph. It's not our triumph in him. It's his triumph. And as that triumph in him is being worked out, it manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him every place. The knowledge of him. What is that? As we decrease, he increases. That's the knowledge of him. When he increases, that's the knowledge of him. We decrease first. That's the prerequisite. And that's the internal working of the cross. Chapter 4, verse 6, for God who said, light shall shine out of darkness. That's in the beginning, tohu abohu. He's citing Genesis 1:3. And that light is not the sun and the moon. This is moral and spiritual light. The darkness is moral and spiritual. It's the result of the fall of Satan. And in that state of tohu abohu, the waste and desolation, God said, let there be light. And so in that natural, physical, created order that was experienced in the judgment of the fall of Satan, God said, let there be light. That's not what day two, day three, the sun and the moon, that comes later. It's not that light. It's moral and spiritual. The darkness is moral and spiritual. But it actually had physical properties to it that restored the earth for the habitation of man. That's in the physical creation. God who said, let there be light. Let light shine out of the darkness. Light is the same God who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Light, knowledge of the glory. Light and glory, face of Jesus Christ. Light, glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Chapter 3, we have the contrast between the two covenants. One is the covenant that is the truth in terms of the letter, and there's that which is the ministry of the Spirit, a ministry of righteousness in terms of the new covenant. The light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ is in contrast, chapter 3, to the light of the glory of God in the face of Moses when he received the law. It was an external manifestation of the glory of God on his face as he received the law. So the law is basically external. It defines the nature and character of God, and it addresses man externally. It does nothing to transform him. The law cannot change man's nature. The law can do nothing to change what we are by nature. It can only reveal the nature of God and condemn what we are in Adam. There's no power. 1 Corinthians 15 says, the strength of sin is the law. When he says, the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, this is the glorified Jesus Christ. Chapter 4, verse 4, is the unbelieving that when the gospel is preached, is the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Christ is the glory of God. He's the glory of God. In the face of Jesus Christ means that who Christ is, he's not governed by an external glory. This glory is coming from within. It's the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ because it's coming from within. It's being manifest in his face, in his person. And we have this treasure, that is the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure where? In our hearts. And in earthen vessels, fragile, that the surpassing greatness of the power may be of God and not from ourselves. We are afflicted in every way. That has to do with the outer man, but not crushed, perplexed, but not despairing, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. This is the process. This is how the formation and the constitution, the revelation of Jesus Christ is being worked into us through the process of sanctification from new birth to the present. We are persecuted but not forsaken, verse 9, struck down but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the necrosis of Jesus, the process of dying of Jesus, that which he went through in his humanity. He picked up his cross, denied himself, and says, not my will but yours be done. Every day he came to do the will of the Father, and I only and always do those things that please him. That's a cross. We cannot please ourselves and please him. If we choose to please him, it's always a cross. You cannot please God and please yourself. We choose to please him, then that pleasure will come back on us. There'll be glory. We have this treasure, the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, who is shining in our heart. We have this in earthen vessels, that the surpassing greatness of power may be of God and not from man. Power from God, not from man, ourselves. Verse 10, always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus, that the life, what life is that? The resurrection life of Jesus may be manifested in our mortal body that is not yet glorified. Romans 8:11. For we who live are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our mortal body. So death is supernaturally and operational in us. But what happens? The life of Christ in us, in this earthen vessel, is released and is supernaturally operational in you. The word works is energized. Verse 16, therefore we do not lose heart and become discouraged, but though our outer man is decaying, the outer man not only refers to a body that is getting older, but it's the outer man as it relates to the soulical man, the soul that is still naturally identified with Adam, the psychikos man, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 14 and following, is decaying, the inner man is being renewed day by day. That's our new creation identity. For the momentary light affliction and suffering is producing, it is working out to a goal for us, an eternal, literally heavyweight of glory, far beyond all comparison, while we look not at the things that are seen, that is, through the eyes of the outer man, but at the things which are not seen, through the eyes of the inner man, the eyes of the heart, Ephesians 1:18. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. 1 Peter 2:9 will bring this to a conclusion for today. We're just looking at facets of the mystery of the Christ and practically how that is to become realized and the person of Christ being formed in us and constituted in us according to the nature of light and ultimately manifests in terms of revelation. 1 Peter chapter 2, he's been citing passages that actually pertain to Israel in the Old Testament. But Israel was a chosen race. We know that from Deuteronomy 10:15, Isaiah 43:20, etc. That's what they are. They're a royal priesthood, but you are a chosen race, an elect race, Christians, 1 Peter 2:9. A royal priesthood, a priesthood that is identified with one with Jesus Christ as the coming king. Royal and kingship go together. A holy nation, that was referred to as Israel according to God's plan in Exodus 19, verse 6. So, spiritually speaking, the church is like a new Israel, not to displace Israel in the plan and purpose of God, but for the dispensation. We, the body of Christ, take the place of Israel. We are the royal ambassadors. We are the holy nation, a people for God's own possession. Hebrew would be private treasure, segula. We are God's own possession, that you may proclaim, ex angelo, that may proclaim and tell out from your innermost being the excellencies, that which defines God in his divine nature expressed, erete, the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Light, to be a partaker of that divine nature, 2 Peter 1 and verse 3. And now I'm going to conclude with the outcome. The outcome, if we take it all the way to the end of the prophetic revelation, we see this amazing finalization, consummation of that which it means to be sons of light, to be made partakers of light, to be light in the Lord, to be walking the light as he is in the light, for that divine nature to be formed and constituted and revealed to us in our mortal bodies, and of course in our resurrection body, there'll be the complete history of our sanctification here on earth displayed in a glorified state using symbolic language in Revelation chapter 21. Notice where it all comes, what happens. We see a bride adorned for her husband, Revelation 21:2. And Revelation 19:7 and 8, a bride made ready, verse 8, clean, fine linen, which is the righteous acts of the saints. This is the marriage of the Lamb, Revelation 19:7. because the Lamb is now adorned for her husband. Verse 9, and one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven plagues, and we see that in Revelation 17, 15, the judgments of the tribulation. One of these seven angels had the seven bowls full of seven last plagues, came to speak with me, saying, come here and I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. The wife of the Lamb has characteristics. The wife of the Lamb, in terms of the administrative, governmental function of the bride of the Messiah, the wife of the Lamb is in terms of a city. When we get to heaven, we're not going to see any city. We are the city. We are the heavenly city. The church is that. But in terms of government, the city polis in the ancient world was the center of government. Athens was the center of government influence for the Grecian Empire, like Rome. It's governmental. So he says, I will show you the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me in the spirit to a great and high mountain. That means dominion. That's the kingdom that is above all kingdoms in Daniel 2 and 7. He showed me the holy city. I will show you the bride. And he showed him the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven, out from God. The city is a bride. The bride is a city. It's symbolic. But the symbolism is something that the reality far transcends the symbol. It doesn't diminish the reality. It means that that which is symbolic can only represent in a way that we can get some verbal definition of what he's talking about. He carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, showed me the holy city of Jerusalem coming down out from heaven and out from God, having the glory of God. The city bride is having, echo, is in possession of the glory of God. Now to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus unto all generations forever. Ephesians 3:21. 2 Thessalonians 2:14, we've been called to gain possession of the glory of Jesus Christ. Well, here it is. The church is in possession. It now has the glory of God in resurrection. Her brilliance, her luminous characteristics as a vessel of light was like a very costly stone. Suffering, untold suffering for this stone to be formed, to be a medium to manifest the glory of God, a stone of crystal clear jasper. Jasper in its natural state is red. It's crystal clear. This is like a diamond. Verse 18, and the material of the wall of the city was jasper, transparent glass. The city was pure. The Greek is clean. No unrighteousness. Clean, holy. Like clear, pure, clean glass. The foundation stones of the city were adorned. Same word for the bride, adorned for her husband, verse 2. Adorned with every precious stone, manifesting the plenitude, the fullness of the divine nature. The first foundation stone was jasper, second sapphire, third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, etc., etc. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each one of the gates was a single pearl, a pearl formed out of suffering. The secretion of that which creates the luminosity and the beauty of the pearl comes through the suffering, that grit, that which is provoking and cutting into the flesh. And the street of the city was, here again, pure, clean gold. Well, the city is not going to be physical gold. It's an analogy. What is gold? Gold is one of the best conductors of electricity. It's incorruptible. You throw acid on it, it's incorruptible in its natural state. It has one of the most properties in physics, the least resistance to electricity. Gold means the life of God and the nature of God can flow through gold without restriction. Gold. God is released in terms of gold. Jesus says in Revelation 3:18, buy from me gold refined in fire. How do you buy gold? I let go of what I am by nature, and I want to become a partaker of that divine nature, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. So I buy gold. I give up what I am to become who you are. I want to become fully a member of the Christ experientially, not just something stated as doctrine. Pure gold, transparent glass, and I saw no holy of holies in there. Ephesians 2:19 through 22, we are now being built as an eternal habitation, a most holy place in the Lord. The church, according to Ephesians 2:19 through 22, we are that most holy place that's now being built up for the habitation of the triune Godhead. And yet, in the end, we don't see this most holy place. All you see is the Lamb. I saw no most holy of holies. But the church is that. Why don't we see the church? For the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb are its temple. The bride, the city, are so one with the Godhead that when you look at the bride, you see Him. We're there. But the conformity to his image is absolute and final and complete. We are still who we are. But what is displayed, what is manifest? Almighty God and the Lamb. Because you see, the church is the wife of the Lamb. The Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb are its most holy place. Holy of holies. And the city has no need of the sun or the moon to govern the day and the night, because there's no day or night anymore. For the glory of God has illumined it, and its lamp is the Lamb. So the Lamb manifests the light. You are light in the Lord, Ephesians 5. The unity is one. The conformity is complete. And this is how it is described. And all the nations, that is, for 1,000 years shall walk in its light. The nations, it'll be Israel's the head of the nations, Gentile nations shall walk in his light. So there's this light that will be manifest from the Godhead through the glorified church over the nations in the 1,000-year reign of Christ, and the kings of the earth shall bring their glory into it. You see? We are now, as the church, the body, bride, the heavenly city in the New Jerusalem, in glorification. And there shall be no night there. Its gates shall never be closed. And they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. And notice, nothing unclean, and no one who practices abominations, idolatry, and lying shall ever come into it. But only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. When Jesus returns, notice the prophecy, and that's where we'll close. We've noticed Isaiah 9, 1 and 2, that was fulfilled when Jesus came at the first advent. And now when he returns at the second advent, notice the prophecy in Isaiah 60. Isaiah 60. You know what I noticed when I was in China? I would go on and on like this for maybe 8 or 10 hours a day. These Chinese people sat on little slats on the floor, and all they did was take notes. And at the end, they didn't want to stop. They didn't want to stop. Can you imagine that? And I noticed when I was there, some of them had watches, some of them didn't. Not one of them ever looked at their watch. I wonder what was going on. There's quite a bit of difference between what has happened at the church in the West and the church that I saw in China. And that's no reflection on you, okay? I'm just saying, generally speaking, okay? Arise, and this is speaking to Zion. Zion would be the Temple Mount where Isaiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, the Messiah will proclaim the law, the divine instruction of the Lord, for 1,000 years from Mount Zion. That's where his throne will be for 1,000 years. Zion, Jerusalem, the people of Israel, who will be identified with this place on earth for 1,000 years, arise, O Zion of God, shine, for your light has come. Your light has come. And the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. The Septuagint, anateleo. That is the same word used in 2 Peter 1:19 for the rising of the morning star. Where does this light come from? It is the effect upon Israel and the nations of Jesus Christ having arisen as the morning star in the heart of the church. This is the consequence, the effect. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Father, the glory you have given me, I have given to them that they may be one even as we are one. That glory is now manifest in the heavenly city. And who that city is will have a manifestation for 1,000 years in union with the three members of the Godhead, Christ manifests through the glorified church, defining Israel, the instrument of the manifestation of the glory of God to Israel through Israel over the nations. So Israel, Zion, the glory of the Lord has arisen like the morning star upon you. For behold, darkness will cover the earth. That's everything leading up to the great and terrible day of the Lord, the last 7 years of Daniel's 70th week, and all the judgments, Isaiah 24, 34, Zephaniah, Joel, all these passages. For behold, the darkness will cover the earth, and deep darkness the peoples. This is everything leading up to the second coming of Christ, the rule of Antichrist. The Lord will rise upon you, Israel, O Zion, and his glory will appear upon you, and the nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of you, Israel. You're arising to that place that I've assigned you to be the head of the nations. And where does that light come from? From those in this dispensation who have become light in the Lord, Ephesians 5. So this that we're looking at are constituents, are fundamental features of the mystery of the Christ. Because the mystery of Christ is only understood in terms of the church. And the church cannot be known and understood apart from who Christ is, as head and body, one entity, organic. For even as the body has many members, yet is still in one body, so also is the Christ. We are members of one another and members of Christ. Romans 12, 3 through 5, Ephesians 4 and 5. Members of Christ, members of one another. Father, we just deposit this into your hands. We cast this upon the hearers, and we recognize Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 and following. Unless you release the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that this remains words. So only you can take the words and breathe life and release light from life into that which has been deposited in your hands. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.